إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار Alhamdulillah, we are gathered on the day of Jum'ah, the day of Friday, the day of gathering. And we start every Friday sermon with the same words, Inna Alhamdulillah, all praise is due to Allah. But often we find ourselves not thinking about who is Allah and why is praise due to Him. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed in His book, the Qur'an, a surah which if you knew, you would know something of Allah, and you would know something of the Qur'an, you would know a third of the Qur'an, and you would know, you would be that much closer to Allah, and you know the light of the Qur'an. And this surah is Surah Al-Ikhlas, the surah of sincerity, and if you knew this surah, you would have sincerity for Allah. And it's also known as Surah Al-Ma'rifah, the surah of knowing, of knowledge. Because if you knew this surah, you would know something of Allah. And it's also known as Sura tawhid, the surah of absolute monotheism. That you would understand that Allah is absolutely one if you knew the surah. And it's also known as Sura Nur al-Qur'an, the surah that is the light of the Qur'an. And we know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Inna likulli shayin nura, wa nur al-Qur'an, qul huwa Allahu ahad. That everything has a light. And the light of the Qur'an is قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ Surah Al-Ikhlas. And we know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said إِنَّهَا تَعَدِينُ ثُنَةَ الْقُرْآنِ That this surah is worth a third of the Qur'an, because if you knew this surah, you know a third of what the Qur'an is trying to tell you. And so we recite the surah every single day, very often. It's always on our tongues. But are we reciting the surah to meet the conditions of prayer and hurry up and move on with our lives? Or can we recite the surah and have some understanding of it and have some meaning and have some feeling that the surah is worth something to us, that it's relevant to us, and that our lives are dictated by what's in the surah. And so before we start even speaking about the surah and before we get into it, we seek refuge from the one who wants to take us away from the Qur'an and wants to take us away from the surah that was revealed to our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one who doesn't want us to appreciate the surah and doesn't want us to realize how important it is. So we start. Before we start, we say, "A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim." We seek refuge from shaytan, the accursed. And then, after we seek refuge from him, we start with the name of Allah. And the two of the most beautiful qualities of Allah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most compassionate, the most merciful. And this name of Allah is known as Ismul Jami', the name of Allah that encompasses all of His qualities and all of His attributes, those of Jalal, those of Majesty, and those of Jamal, those that are beautiful, such as His His anger, that's a quality of His majesty, and then of His compassion and His love, that's of His jamal, that's of Allah's beauty. And then when we start, Allah first of all gives us the all-encompassing name, and then He gives us two of His most beautiful qualities. We know that this, we recite this every single day, that that Allah is the most compassionate and the most merciful, and that everything we see is a manifestation of Allah's mercy and of His compassion. And that the biggest manifestation of Allah's mercy and His compassion is the fact that we were given the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Allah says in Surah Al-Anbiya, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we haven't sent you except as a mercy to all of mankind. And the miracle of this mercy, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was the Qur'an. And Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi said about the Qur'an that it's like an oyster. And we know that an oyster has a gem in it known as a pearl. And then he said that the pearl of the Qur'an is Surah Al-Ikhlas. And so that we've been given this pearl as a mercy and as compassion from Allah, we've been given a source to know something of Allah. And so the first ayah starts, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ, say, proclaim that Allah is Ahad, the One, the uniquely and the singularly One, the indivisible, the One that nothing can be subtracted from and nothing can be added to, that it can't be divided into parts and it can't be multiplied into more than one. But that is Allah. Allah is, He didn't say Allahu Wahidun, that Allah is one, because He didn't say Allahu Wahidun. Wahidun is the one that can be counted, the one that can be divided, the one that can be added to and subtracted from. But Allah is the absolutely one in all of His aspects, in His essence and in His attributes and in His actions, that Allah is absolutely one, that none can compare to Him. And that only Allah, the One, has the right to describe Himself with these lofty qualities that he's given Himself, of mercy and of compassion and of power and of absolute will. That we haven't been given the ability to describe ourselves with these qualities. Only Allah is the absolutely powerful and the absolutely compassionate and the absolutely merciful and the absolutely willing. Then he starts with the pronoun He. He, Allah, is one. And then who is this one? Allahu Samad. Allah is eternally sufficient unto Himself. That Allah doesn't need permission to create, He doesn't need permission to take away, to give, and He doesn't need permission to do any of His actions. That we need permission to do what we do. That Allah doesn't need permission. And that Allah didn't need permission to create us. And Allah doesn't need our worship, and He doesn't need our praise, and He doesn't need our istighfar, He doesn't need us to seek mercy from Him. That if Allah needed something, then He would be dependent on someone else. But Allah is not dependent on anyone else. And he doesn't need any of this from us, but we're in need of it from Him. That we need to worship Him, and we need to praise Him, and we need to ask istighfar from Him. We need to seek forgiveness from Him. Because if we don't, Allah can easily replace us. Allah can easily show us how dependent we are on Him, and how much we need to worship Him. Because on the Yawm al-Qiyamah, He's going to show us whether we worshipped Him or not. And if we worshipped Him, perhaps He'll show some mercy on us and He'll let us into Jannah. But if we didn't, then Allah can, even if we did worship Him, He can throw us in the hellfire. But if we have some excuse for Allah to put us in the Jannah, for some reason to Allah to say that I will give you Jannah because of this or because of that, that we ask that Allah gives us that, and that Allah, that we realize that we're dependent on Allah for that, that He isn't dependent on us. He is As-Samad, the one that doesn't need anyone, that He in and of Himself created, He didn't need anyone to create Him, and He doesn't need to create anyone like Him. So then Allah says, لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ, that He didn't beget, that He didn't have any children, any sons or daughters. That the Christians, we know that they ascribed a son to Allah, and that the pagan Arabs, they ascribed daughters to Allah, and they said that the angels were daughters of Allah. And we know that Allah makes none like Him. If Allah made any like Him, then there would be something that can go against His will. But we know nothing can go Allah's will. And so when He says, وَلَمْ يُولَدْ, that he didn't create and He didn't beget, that he wasn't begotten, that He wasn't in need of anyone to create Him, that He is above space and time, He is transcendent of space and time, that He doesn't exist in the location and He doesn't exist in time, that Allah, our language is not even capable of describing Allah. When we say that Allah had created, we're saying had, which is in time. Or Allah is creating, that Allah is creating something that's in time, or Allah will create. That's from our perspective, that's from the way we see things. But Allah doesn't see things in time. Allah is, and that is, that's it. That Allah creates, and it's always in a moment. It's not in a moment. That Allah, when He creates, the way we see it in moments, but Allah, He's above that. He doesn't need the limitations of time and space. And He doesn't need the limitations of when something is created. And so we know from that when He doesn't need anything, because nothing is like Him, and He doesn't need to answer to anyone, and only we need to answer to Him. Then the next ayah, He says, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. And this is one of the most important ayat of understanding something of Allah. This is the ayat that points to لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Nothing is, not a single thing is like Allah. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Yet He is all-seeing and all-merciful, and all-seeing and all-hearing. That though Allah sees and He hears, it's not like the way we see and hear. That it's not the way that, when He has some power over something, it's not the way we have power over something. When we will something, it's not the way that Allah will something. That is completely different, and the way we will something, and the way we hear, and the way we see is just, it's simply a way for us to understand something of how absolute hearing and absolute power and absolute seeing works. And so Allah reveals all His attributes to us in some way or another. That when we see something, a natural disaster, that's a revelation of, that's a manifestation of Allah's Jalal, His Majesty, His absolute ability to do whatever He likes. And then when we see something beautiful, that's a manifestation of His Jalal, so that we understand something of beauty and understand that Allah is even more beautiful than that. That when Allah gives us the beautiful trees and the flowers that we look at, that we think to ourselves, رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا. That Allah, You didn't create this for nothing. But You created this so that we can understand something about this. And that we can understand that Allah put this here so that we know something of beauty, so we can appreciate beauty, and then appreciate the absolutely beautiful, which is Allah. And so Allah, He's expressed some of Himself in this surah. He's given us some qualities of Himself, that if we knew these qualities, we wouldn't have these problems of what to believe and what not to believe. That if we truly understood this surah, that we would be able to know that what our limit is in asking of what is Allah, and what is that, and what isn't Allah, and that we know that we can never truly understand Him, and because we can never truly understand Him, that we can never truly worship Him the way He should be worshipped, but it's still upon us to try. And which is one of the reasons why we make istighfar after a prayer. After the prayer, what do we say? Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. We ask forgiveness right after we've done an act of worship, because Allah has shown us that in this prayer you haven't done enough, and you should make istighfar that because you haven't done enough, and that you wish that you could do more. And so inshallah, during the next part of the khutbah, we'll get into it. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. And so now that we have this knowledge that Allah has given us in this beautiful surah, this magnanimous surah, the surah that hasn't been like the likes of it hasn't been given to any other ummah before us, we have to do something with it. Knowing something is not the same as knowledge. Knowing something is like data and facts, and knowledge is actually applying those data and facts. And so that's what true knowledge is. And so with this knowledge, what we do is we worship Allah as He should be worshipped. You know, in the hadith Jibreel, that after the section on Iman, what belief is and what we should believe, that Allah gives us the next step, which is Ihsan, to apply what we believe into ourselves, and that we worship Allah as He should, as we see Him, and we know that we can't see Allah in the dunya, so that we recognize that Allah sees us, because He's the all-powerful, and He is the one, the only one that sees us in all our states, and the only one that knows our intentions, that He knows us better than we know ourselves. And because He knows us better than we know ourselves, it's our responsibility to appreciate that and worship Him. And so that when we know this, that when we do our prayers, we do it with perfection, and when we make dua to Allah, that we do it with perfection, and we do it with to the absolute best of our ability. And what's really interesting is that after this surah, Surah Al-Ikhlas, we have the next two surahs, Surah Al-Falaq and Surah Al-Nas. And these two surahs is where we're asking something from Allah, because now that you understand Surah Al-Ikhlas, now you can ask something from Allah. Because you understand that Allah is the only one that can give you. And it wasn't the other way around. And so, now that we've understood, we should be grateful for the blessings that we've been given. And we should be grateful for the fact that Allah has sent down His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with His miracle, which is the Qur'an, and with that pearl of the Qur'an, which is Surah Al-Ikhlas, so that we can know something of the one who created the Messenger of Allah, the one who gave us the Qur'an, and the one who created us, and the one who created the situations that we're in, and the one who created the difficulties and the hardships, and the one who created the ease that we are in, and that we are responsible to praise Allah for that, and also that we are responsible to thank Allah for the blessings that we've been given, and that we've been given the blessing of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that we know that Allah says in the Qur'an, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ. Indeed, Allah and His angels send the blessings and greetings upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is an action that Allah does. And then He commands us to do the same. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصلِّ عليه. اللهم أنت السلام ومنك السلام، تباركت يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، حينا وأدخلنا دار السلام، حينا وأدخلنا دار السلام، حينا وأدخلنا دار السلام. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، وأذل الشرك والمشركين، ودمر أعداء الدين، واحمي حوزة الإسلام، واجمع كلمة المسلمين على الحق يا رب العالمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة عين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.